Hello, I'm John Doyle, the Artistic Director of Classic Stage Company, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to Classic Conversations. For some considerable time now, we've been presenting this series of informal chats between myself and artists that I know and I admire. It's my great pleasure to welcome this week's guest, writer Marcus Gardley. Marcus, great to see you.
It's great to see you.
How are you?
I'm great. I'm actually very well, thank you.
You busy writing?
Very busy, working on a couple of film projects and a TV project, and doing a lot of reading, which is the pandemic has provided the time to do that. So.
Isn't that wonderful? I know, I've read more stuff for the last year, it's incredible. Now, I know that just before this call, you were in the writer's room working on something. I have never been in a writer's room, right? And I've always thought, how does it work? I mean, does one person, does the showrunner of the piece that you're working on, do they manage the room? How does that happen? What happens?
That's a really beautiful question. So yes, the showrunner, not only do they manage the room, but they'll actually manage when they get on set, when they're actually shooting the TV show, they'll manage that environment as well.
Yeah.
There'll be a director, but they're really the man or woman in charge. But in the writer's room, believe it or not, it's actually a lot like a rehearsal room in the theater. So, but instead of actors, everybody's a writer, right? But it's people coming up with the best idea, trying to solve usually a problem in the writing. But when you arrive in the writer's room, for the most part, the story has already been beaten out. So the story beats of the TV show, for the most part, have already been decided. And so it's that the nuance, it's those little, what can we create it? Like a cliffhanger in this scene, those kind of discussions.
Okay. And then does somebody take all that information away and write the text, or do you all write the text together?
No, so we all beat out the entire season together, and then everyone gets an episode, and then they have to go away and they write an outline for the episode and then the actual episode.
Do you like it?
I love it.
Do you?
I do love it. I mean, nothing will replace the theater. I think having that director and that actor not in the room it's not as exciting with all the players there in this space. But I'm a big collaborator, and I love creating a story not only by myself, right? I want more people there and more ideas there, and I think it just makes the story better.
How fantastic.
Yes.
So where did it all begin? I mean, am I right in thinking that you were originally thinking of being a poet?
Absolutely. And did poetry I wrote poetry when I was a kid, and I don't remember not writing poetry.
Wow.
So the farthest my memories go back, I was writing. And I never forget, I was in third grade, I believe, and I wrote a short story, but it was a poem. It was like an epic poem. And my teacher had me read it in class, and every student in the class, including the teacher, I had put them in the poem and given them an adjective that started with the letter as their name. So like Wonderful Will Height was my teacher's name. Last name was Miss Will Height. So Wonderful Will Height. And so I saw all the students laugh when their name was read, and they loved the little, adjective I gave them. And it was theater, because it was me having a conversation with the audience, and I knew there was something there. I wasn't quite there, but I knew that that's where I belonged as an artist.
Sure, sure. But did you then do poetry at university, or how did that figure out?
Yes, sorry. So yes, when I went to undergrad at San Francisco State, I wasn't majoring in theater at all. I actually was a French major. I was majoring in French and African American studies, and I had intended to do international business. But I still was writing poetry and going to open mics and reading, spoken word and doing that kind of thing. But I always felt like poetry was too much fun. It couldn't be, there's no way you're going to be paid. Anybody was going to pay me to do that. that was impossible. And then the funny thing happened. I did very well in the French major. And in the senior year, the idea was that you would study abroad in Paris. That was part of the program. And I couldn't afford to do it, even though I got very high marks. And so the dean at the time said to me, you should take a year off and save. And then you'll be able to do that. And so when I took that year off, I thought, well, let me just take this playwriting class. I've always wanted to know what that was like. And John, I tell you, that first week, I knew.
You knew straight away.
I changed my whole life.
How wonderful.
I knew straight away that this
How
is,
wonderful.
Yeah, it was great.
And of course, then that love of poetry could lie in the playmaking. I mean, it's
Absolutely.
The same. It's just a different formatting of the word, but it's still the word, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Am I correct in remembering? The first time you and I spoke, which was on Zoom as well, we've never actually met in real person. I mean, it's like a whole new thing, isn't it? There are Zoom relationships and then there are real life relationships.
Right.
But at the beginning of our Zoom relationship, I remember that, am I right in thinking that your grandma had just passed away? Is that correct?
That's absolutely correct. Thank you for remembering. She was 103.
I know.
Yeah, she was 103 and she just passed away. And it's amazing because in our family, she is the griot. She is the person that carries all the stories. She has all the memories. She's very, very sharp. And then she loved, of course, when I told her that I was dedicating my life to writing, because she was like, great, you're going to carry on our stories. That's like the biggest honor to have. But she did have, unfortunately, she did have COVID, but she beat COVID, surprisingly. But I think it took such a toll on her body that it was a month later we lost her. But she lived a big life and she was a huge influence on me. And I'm glad I had that time with her.
Did you write down her stories?
I did. So my play, I have this play called And Jesus Moonwalks the Mississippi. Yes. That's all her story. So that's all her story. Yeah, that's all her story. It's obviously fantasized in a way and reimagined, but it is the story she always told me about her father who freed himself from slavery. She always started this tale by saying, this is the story of Madison Eaton who freed himself from slavery. That's always the first line. And so in the play, there's a character, his name is not Madison Eaton, but in the play, there's a character who dresses up as a woman because at that time it was easy for women to travel as African-Americans to the North. And so her father did that. And it's an incredible story of how he freed himself. It's a beautiful story.
Extraordinary as well that you are, so, you know, there's that direct line between that awfulness and you now, right?
Absolutely.
Through that one woman. How wonderful is that?
It's a huge gift.
I knew my great grandfather very, very well. He lived till he was 96, and I was in my mid 20s when he died. And I spent a lot of time with him. And I remember one day sitting down with him. We were watching television, and it was a long time ago now, but we watched Man Landing on the Moon together, right, on the TV.
Yes.
And he was not a sentimental man, or, you know, he was a big Scottish, not dour, but solid guy, right? He would not ever show his feelings very much. He was kind and everything, but his emotions weren't on the surface. And I looked around as I was watching the television with him, and tears were coming down his face. And I said, Granddad, we always called him as opposed to great-granddad. Granddad, are you all right? He said, I can't believe what I'm seeing. My first job was to ride a horse and carriage to take the children to school. And now I'm watching a man landing on the moon. And I was so thrilled that I was there at that moment in time and thinking, there's that direct, beautiful connection between his story and mine, you know. And now that I have grandchildren of my own, I think, God, I must write stuff down for them.
Yes.
It'll go. I mean, in my case, I put it into my work like you do, but at least yours is written down, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. It's
important. Am I also correct in remembering that you said that you come from a big family?
Massive, massive family. So my dad has 10 sisters and 4 brothers.
My God.
Yeah, and 4 brothers. And my mother was raised with her cousins. So if you add all of them, they were about 11, somewhere around 11, huge. And then all those people have children, all of them.
Are there other artists in that big group of people?
Do you know what? The only other artists are my siblings. So really? We're all writers. Yeah, my brother's a poet and my sister writes fiction. We're all writers. Yeah.
I did not know that.
Yeah. We're all writers.
How did that happen? I mean, were there like a lot of books in the house?
Lots of books. Mother was an avid reader and my father's a pastor. So, you know, there was also the love of like the oratory nature of, you know, delivering text.
The
word, absolutely.
Yeah.
And he would always say to us, I can call you at the pulpit at any time. So I have something prepared, you know, so we were always constantly. So there was that. But my parents, I had the best childhood, John, I have to say. It was incredible. My parents, they created a world for us to exist where we could do anything. So we presented plays that we wrote for them that they would sit and watch for hours. They didn't allow us to watch a lot of TV. And so we had to, you know, we had to use our own imagination to come up with things. And I think that's why we're all writers. We loved books, but we also loved telling stories. And we had this, again, it was my great grandmother, even though we call her grandmother. I love that you said that. But when we would meet as a family, we would all sit around her and she would tell stories. So we had all this.
The oral tradition.
Around our life. Yeah, the oral tradition around our life. But I'm curious, I was going to ask you too, sorry. I'm curious about that moment where you decided to be a director. Like, what was that?
Well, you know, it's linked to the church, actually. Funny you talked about your dad. I'm an only child. I come from a big family, but I myself am an only child. We didn't have television until I was, 11, I think, maybe, something like that. Yeah. So I spent a lot of my early life listening to the radio.
Yes.
And if it was in Great Britain, there was a strong tradition of, you know, like every Saturday evening on, you sat down at the radio in the front room, as we called it, the parlor or whatever, in a tiny house that we had, and you listened to a play. Okay, so we had every Saturday night, there was the 8 o'clock armchair theater, it was called, and you listened to a play. And of course, it was done by the BBC rep. So it was a repertory company of actors employed by the BBC, I think it still exists actually.
That's amazing.
Who, you know, did 52 plays a year, readings, of course.
Yes.
But they were wonderful at it. And so yeah. I think that was part of it. Then, you know, I was a good boy. So I went to church and I was very, very interested in the ministry in the Protestant church. And then I was accepted to go and read divinity at university. And almost at the last minute, I thought, I think I'll go and see what it's like to apply for drama school. I was only 17. And that really started, and I got in and I thought, well, I can do the ministry another time. And there's many times in my life where I've thought, I'll do the ministry now, but then it's too late now. But there's a definite connection for me with the church and the theater in that sense. Yeah. You've possibly seen it in my work a little bit, right?
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely.
But I, in terms of being a director, you know, I went to school in Britain, and then I had a scholarship to come to America. I went to the University of Georgia, Athens, Georgia, 1973. It was a very, very different world, Marcus.
Right.
Maybe not different enough world, but it was a different world. And so that was great. And I worked with some great professors, and I went back to Britain and I became we called them acting ASM, like a young actor who also did stage management in the company, you know, that very repertory tradition, ensemble tradition, you know what that is. And a woman who was leading the company, who was running the theater, said to me, we'd like you to do the next play. And I'd never directed Traffic, you know, I mean, I didn't have the first idea. But of course I was 21 and I was completely fearless, and I've been directing plays ever since. So I didn't actually choose to do it. Somebody chose me to do it. She, and then after that, actually, I didn't really ever have any more contact with her, but I wouldn't have had a career had she not somehow seen something in me that, there was a bar in that theater. And at the end of the night, once we'd done our plays, we would all sit down in the bar. It was quite in a remote place in Scotland, and in the pub. And I would sing, because I used to sing a lot. And I sang Scottish songs. And I can remember her watching me, and she obviously thought, oh, he's a storyteller. It's just the way I would sing these songs, because they were songs that were taught to me as a child. Yes. And she somehow picked up on that. I think that started the ball rolling. And there have been many times where I thought, why am I doing this? But all these hundreds of plays later, you know, that's just how it is, really. But listen, you went to Yale.
Absolutely.
By this point, with the intent of being a playwright.
Oh, for sure.
That's what was happening.
Yeah, and I went right after. So when at this moment where I told you where I took this playwriting class, and I knew, I literally 4 or 5 months later applied to the Yale Drama School, and I had dedicated all my hours. I never forget, I would run home after work and write plays, and I applied to the Yale Drama School, and I I just something new was in me. I knew that if I didn't get in there, I was going to get into other places that I applied. So,
wonderful. Yeah. And then pretty quickly, you yourself were teaching. I mean, you were working at Columbia. Absolutely. You now have a position, don't you, at Brown. I mean, how did all that happen?
Well, you know, So the first job I got right out of the drama school was Columbia, and it was a peer of mine at Yale's sister hired me, and she was a big fan of my plays, and she said, you should come and teach. And so I came because I knew I was moving to New York anyway, and I lived in Harlem. And so I always had a love for teaching, but because that was sort of wrapped in my love for writing and reading and just having this community of artists, I really loved teaching poetry. And I really loved teaching playwriting. And so it was all those things that like excited me as a young person, I was actually passing down. And I would always do this thing, because I was fairly young when I first started. So I would do this thing on the first day, I would sit amongst the students. I wouldn't sit at the front. So nobody knew. They would thought the professor was late or the instructor was late. And then I would wait till, you know, the room was full, and I would say, okay, look. I said, look at the top of the class. They always stare at me, of course, but I say, look at the front of the class, and they all look. And I said, no, everybody turn around, look at the front of the class. And I said, what do you see? And they all said, we don't see anything. I said, exactly. I said, now look amongst you. And they would all look amongst you. I said, that's who's going to teach you.
Yeah, that's right.
And you see, I'm amongst you as well. We're all going to teach each other. So this is not about hierarchy. Don't try to please me. Don't try to get an A. Nope. It's about let's learn together. And I still hold by that rule. When I'm in the theater, it's like, the story is the leader, right? We make this together, yeah.
That's right. I mean, I teach at Princeton. I have a professorship at Princeton. And I if the class is good, it's because we're all teaching each other.
That's right.
In those very, I'm going to use the word elitist. It's an unfair word to use, actually. But in those very rarefied environments, let's put it that way. You know, the students often don't find it easy to take that approach because they paid a lot of money. Where's the professor? You know, but it's interesting. I'm teaching a class right now there, a particular class, which is about the history of, it's about the history of the American musical and where it came from and where it's going to. And I so look forward to that class every Monday, even though we have to teach it on Zoom. I don't like doing that particularly, yeah. But I really look forward to it. And I come away from it thinking, I learned so much today. And that's the answer, isn't it, really?
That really is.
And that's the answer, you're right. That's the answer in a rehearsal room. I mean, the play is the thing. The play teaches you, that's your therapy. That's how you find out about yourself.
Absolutely. And I don't know if you have this, John, too, but I find that I've been doing this a long time, and I always find that I'm always learning something new, and that's so thrilling. I'm always learning a new little tactic of how to like achieve a story or an emotional impact of, you know, in a moment, or like I was writing this film I just finished. I had a friend read it, and she was explaining to me how it made her feel. And I thought, oh, but it's not right. I don't want you to feel that thing. And we were talking about strategies of getting around the way, you know, getting across what I wanted. But I get so excited about learning, and that I feel like as an artist, it's endless. There's so much to learn. There's so much to learn about other people, other cultures. Yeah.
Oh yes, that every single rehearsal period, I think, is such a journey on its own, and a scary journey. I mean, yes. Wonderful and terrifying both at the same time. And for me, as the years have gone on, it's just really about staying out of the way. Yes. You know, tell the story. Don't get in the way of the story. Right. Don't block the story by your own, whatever it might be, fears, or, well, the fears are all right, but your own ego maybe, or allowing somebody else's ego to dominate the story. Let the words do the work.
That's, you know, right.
I've never lost the love of words, thank goodness.
Yes.
You know, I'm fearful in the modern world of what's happening to words, but it's a glorious thing. So tell me about the company in Chicago that you have a relationship, it's the ensemble company. Tell me about them.
So that's Victory Gardens, and I've been associated with them, I think almost 10 years now. It's been a good while. And at one point I was writing a play for them every year. So it was sort of like, you know, this Shakespearean model where I was a playwright in residence, and every year they were doing a play. And it was a huge honor, John, because every play, the the only charge that I received from the artistic director was it needed to be in some way about Chicago. Mm-hmm. And so because I was living in Chicago, it was great. And it was just a beautiful way. And Chicago theater goers, much like New Yorkers, are theater is their life. So they come to the rehearsal, you know, they had open rehearsal, they would come to the rehearsals, but they would sit long after the play was finished and talk about the work. And again, wonderful. What's more thrilling than that? And sometimes, you know, they would get really passionate about what they saw, which I also loved. And then sometimes they would be moved speechless by what they saw. And it was just really great to have that experience at the theater. So it was, there's quite a few playwrights in residence there. I think it was maybe like seven of us, but I was there and had the beautiful opportunity to write a play a year. And I really watched my growth as a writer, because not only were audiences becoming really close to me as being a community member, but they really started to understand what I was up to as an artist. And that was exciting. And because I know the first play that was like, you know, what's going on? And then slowly by slowly, they felt like they became experts. And I thought, wow, what a huge gift that is. Yeah, it was incredible.
Very moving if somebody, it happens to me sometimes, you know, people will talk to me about things of mine that they've seen that I can't even remember that I did, you know, yeah. And talk to you about your body of work. And and it's a fascinating thing, because you don't know you're having a body of work.
Absolutely not.
You're just doing the next gig. And right. They're viewing your story and you think, oh, how extraordinary that is. So does that ensemble also have an ensemble of actors?
They do not have an ensemble of actors. And they've just now, this current resident of playwrights have moved on. They have a younger group, which is beautiful. Okay. To have
it's all about the playwright.
It's all about the playwrights. It's definitely, I would say, playwright driven and new work driven.
Fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now I'm interested to ask you, as you know, here I am, a man who is trying to lead a company called Classic Stage Company in America. I'm not an American, as you know, and yet I'm trying to do this in New York City in 2021. And your work, or the work that I really know of yours and have read of yours, much of it is rooted in the classics, is it not?
Absolutely. I would say 90% of my work is rooted in the classics. This goes back to your great question earlier about, you know, my upbringing and why are my siblings writers? So we read the classics. That was my dad's thing, because of course he's a minister. So, you know, he was like, if you want to know the world, read the classics. If you want to know what people are going to be talking about 20 years from now, read the classics. And we loved it. We became obsessed with myths, which is interesting too, because what myths did for us, and I'm curious about your own upbringing in this regard, but what myths did for us, it made us question the Bible.
Yeah.
Right. It made us question some of the things. And my dad was like, wait, what? Hold on. And we were like, and to me, that's when I really started to have an intimate relationship with faith. Because when I was starting questioning it, then it felt like, oh, this is actually more intimate than I ever perceived it. But, you know, if my dad was able to challenge, you know, Zeus is not a real person, that's not a real God. So I said, okay, well, what about these two scriptures that feel like they're contradicting? You know, yeah. What I mean? So those kind of things were, yeah. And that's why I became a writer, because I really wanted to me, it's about the question, the golden question is what I always say. What is the question of the play? And I never want to answer it. I want to ask it, and I want to figure out what we can do with this question. How can we solve this problem? So,
and that there's a reason why those myths have lasted. You know,
yes,
tell us so much about ourselves. I mean, just what you're saying there about the Bible, for example. You know, you take the Old Testament and the New Testament, and so many of them are different versions of the same story.
That's right. But
they're the same characters reflected. And right. If you read them side by side, you think, oh, wait a minute, this is stealing from this.
That's right. A thousand years
ago, this. And it's the same notion with the classics, isn't it, really? But I'm delighted to say that obviously what you've done is you've taken classic stories. Interesting to me that you've been influenced by, you know, the Black Odyssey, for example, you know, you've been influenced by the epic poem.
Yes.
The myth tale, the Lorca play, you know, yes. That he's yes. A poet as well as a playwright, obviously, right. almost more of a poet, really. But with presumably a drive, a passion to take those into cultures that are familiar to you, that you know, that you understand. Was that the case from the beginning? Was that a mission of yours?
Oh, I love this question. It wasn't a mission initially. I think I was grappling with the idea that I had these myths and these classic stories that I loved. And then me and my brother had a challenge for each other when we were growing up, where we were going to read who could read all the books in the young adult session faster. And my brother says brilliant. He's a brilliant scholar. He beat me, but when I got to the end, I said, there are not enough stories about me. I said, where are the stories about our culture? And my brother, being wizened even then, said, you have to write them.
You have
You
to write.
have to write them, otherwise they're not gonna. And so when so a piece like Black Odyssey, or even the Lorca piece, The House Will Not Stand, it's me sort of bridging where I am, where am I at in part, where's the culture at in part of this classical conversation, right? And part of these masterpieces, where do we see ourselves? And very much being American, it's a reflection of not just Africa, it's a reflection of our history as Americans,
Yes.
our history as humans on the planet.
Yes.
So all of those things have to be in conversation to really get a really, what I call a complicated and beautiful view of who we are, who we all are as Americans, who we are as people on the planet. So with Black Odyssey, I'm obviously taking those iconic characters from Greek myth, but they identify as Africans, right? So they're African gods. And yet, the story that they're all the characters are really grappling with is my own personal story.
Yes.
It's the story of my family. So all those, I don't, you probably couldn't tell, but those characters you meet are literally people in my history,
Well,
ancestors in my
I
history.
couldn't tell that, but I could certainly tell when I read the play that they're very familiar to you. I mean, and
That's
that
right.
I understand
That's right.
for sure. It's so interesting. I mean, it both saddens me and excites me that it's taken a pandemic and the actions of last, the awfulness of last summer, George Floyd and all that goes with it. It's
Yes.
taken that cataclysmic experience to make companies like Classic Stage stop and say, oh, wait a minute, what does classic mean in America today? Right? And I'm not saying that that conversation wasn't bubbling along, it was. But it was bubbling along in a sort of sporadic kind of way, as opposed to an intrinsic way. And as a foreigner, I'm amazed that that conversation hasn't happened earlier in the American theater. Do you know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. Absolutely. What I love the most about the theater is that it's sexy. It's a sexy art, right? It's very sexy. But when it's really at its best, I feel like it's when it's political. And I don't actually necessarily mean it doesn't have to always be, let's go out and march. I think that is relevant and powerful, and we should do that too. But at its nature, it's radical. It's rebellious, just the idea of like people gathering in a space, closing the door, and then the people on stage that are live, they're not on the screen. Live can say anything they want to you. You know what I mean? And you can respond because you can walk out, which you should never do, but you can walk out, you can shuffle in your chair, you can do all of these things. And it's a real conversation with real people happening in real time. And so, the notion of I think what's happening to us now in the theater is because it is intrinsically already tied to the political moment that people are grappling in with the real way. And I think oftentimes the reason why we have ignored, our role, and I speak for everybody, I'm generally speaking, but why we have ignored our role politically is because it's so hard to make. It's so
Yes.
hard to make theater that just the day-to-day work of making it is so exhausting that we often forget our role as artists in the political, conversation. But to go back to this classic thing is a really powerful word, because when I think of classic, I think of enduring. I think of the story that will not sleep, that it's always as relevant for the present day as it is for the past. And we are always making it, right? We are always adding to that classic, that enduring conversation.
I
And
agree. I agree. I mean, I use the word great. These are great stories. They are about the potential for our greatness.
I
They
love
don't
that.
have to be, they don't even have to be old stories, actually.
That's right.
A new play could be that. I mean, it doesn't have to be something that was written in 15 something by some old white guy dead. No, it can be something else other than that. And you know, I mean, I think it's not unfortunate. It's part of an evolution that so much of the, it seems to me that so much of the American theater, it has seen its classicism as being Eurocentric. And I'm excited by the fact that that's changing. That's changing. That's a wonderful thing. Now, we couldn't have this conversation without sharing the one story that we have in common, right? Yeah. Story that I directed on Broadway and that you've adapted for the world of film, right? Talk to me about that. Talk to me about doing The Color Purple.
The Color Purple is probably so far the most, having the gift and the honor to write the screenplay based on the musical that you worked on, a beautiful production that I saw, as I told you, 12, 13 times. But I say that moment of having the honor to work on that script and retell that story or adapt that story was to me the most meaningful so far in my career, because it was the book I read when me and my brother were having that challenge to read the YA, all the books in the YA, and that was one of the books that I read. And the reason why I lost, that book was the reason why I lost, because when I read it, I kept rereading it.
Yeah.
And I always described it as this, I knew this book would be my friend, and I carried it around, and I never forget my mother finding it and saying, you can't read this book, these materials is too advanced for you. And but that character of Celie, her loneliness, I related to that. I always related to her loneliness, felt like she was writing about me. And then the boldness of a character to write to God, to say, dear God, and then God become, you know, so big in her life, but at the same time, so intimate. Like, I know I mentioned that before. And so that dear God can mean different things. It's dear God as in like, I'm writing to you, so dear God, but also dear as in sweet God. But it's hard to explain, but the God in her world is very present and at the same time at her level. And I mean that in the most, you know.
No, I know exactly what you mean.
And that's a loving God to me. That is a loving God and the God of nature.
The tragedy of the story really is that she almost loses that God.
That's exactly right. That is the tragedy.
And then she resurrects from that in the same way that the Bible story would tell you about resurrection.
Absolutely.
Talk to me about the loneliness, though. Did you feel lonely as a child?
I did feel lonely as a child. I think, so in my family, because there's so many people, the way that you stand out is you have to be loud. You have to be loud and boisterous. So all of them are. If you ever, John Wendell, I'll have you meet them all. And they're very, and they're the most lovely people in the world, but they live large in life, right? They're very colorful. They're extremely funny. They sing, they dance. They're very, very charismatic people. But that's just not in my DNA. My DNA is I'm always the quiet, you know, kind of shy type person. And, you know, and I just always felt like I'm never going to be up to their level. They walk into a room, all of them, they walk into a room and immediately, you know what I mean? And there was a moment, I never forget, my uncle went to Africa and he came back and he forgot that I was existed, because he brought gifts for the other kids and didn't bring anything for me. And that it confirmed for me that I could be lost, right? That I exist in the shadows and I could be lost. And I'm so grateful for my mother. My mother made him give all the gifts back and said, if you can't remember Marcus, you can't, none of the children can get gifts. You know what I mean? And I know he meant well, but it was like it had a big influence on me. And my brother, being my champion always, said, you've got to live, you got to make your mark in the world. You've got to do more. So yeah, you've got to speak up so that, you know, otherwise you'll get run over. And he used to always like, you know, no one would touch me because they were all scared of him. He was literally like super champion. And even to this day, you know, you want to make him mad, say something bad about him. He's always been that, an angel in that way. But he's like, I can't do this your whole life. You've got to speak out. And again, why I became a writer is because I'm not going to be the guy yelling the loudest in the room, but I can write. I can write that loudness on the page.
You can do it with a pen. Absolutely. That's right. So in your experience of working on the musical for the movies,
yes.
Two questions, really. One, did you get to meet or spend any time with Alice Walker?
I did. Now, this was during the pandemic mostly, so it was mostly via Zoom and email. But, you know, I'm curious if you got this as well. I'm sure you did. But I was, Scott, the producer, told me early, he said that Alice Walker's ancestors are very present. They will move things around and make that known. And that was during the writing process. They were very present in my life, at least energy wise. And she was as well. And I was great. I'm obviously a massive fan of hers, but it was great to have her support. She was supportive all the way. And I never forget, she sent me a series of notes, which were incredible. And I replied to her and said, thank you for the notes. And she said, young man, you should do what you want. These are just my ideas.
I'm sure. I can believe that. She was there when we were rehearsing for Broadway, and it was the same. She said, almost nothing. I mean, really nothing. But I knew exactly what she was thinking. You're right. It was like she was surrounded by a whole lot of people, and yet she was totally in her own space. There was nobody really. But I get what you're saying. The ancestors were there. And it was a very moving and humbling experience to be in her presence. Yes, absolutely. So how do you take a piece like that, Marcus, which I think of, that the musical, I'm not talking about the book, which, like you, the book was why I did the piece in the end. Not talking about the book, I'm not even talking about the making of the movie if it were just the story, right? But making writing a movie script of a musical of that story, which I see as being very theatrical, the nature of it being a musical. How do you marry that theatricality with the knowledge that you are writing for a form that, I'm not saying that doesn't have theatricality, but that is not necessarily overtly so? How do you do that?
I love this question, because also the theatricality on screen can be sensory overload if you're not careful, because there's so much going on, you know what I mean? You have the musical element and the dance, and it can just feel like too much. And the thing that when I sit down and write something, I always have a little post-it and I go, I have to give myself rules. Otherwise it'd be chaos. And so I said, okay, here are the rules. And I try to study, what are the themes in the story? I said, what message do I want to get across? And the thing that occurred to me the most with this particular project was, what I love about musicals is that it's the one few art forms in which a character can tell you their deepest, most innermost thoughts, and only you as the audience can hear it.
Yeah.
You really don't get, and it's beautifully delivered, right? Because what's more beautiful than music? Yeah. And so it's one of those moments that I thought, okay, so this has got to feel like those letters to God, these songs. Like, how do I achieve that? And so to me, the music became magic. It had to be, and that's the way I described it when I pitched it to the producers, is that when they sing, it's magic. And these people that live in this town have no money, right? They're very, very poor. They work hard, you know, they're not gonna live a long time. Yeah. So this music, which is historically accurate, would have been their power. Right. And so when they're singing, they're casting spells, right? They're enchanting people. They're making people fall in love with them. They can also be use it negatively, so they can imprison someone. You know what I mean? Yeah. And so in that way, music becomes the power. It becomes the way they express themselves. And so that was my main goal throughout, that the music had to come from a real place. It had to be delivered in a visual way, because it's now a film, and it had to speak to the innermost secrets of that character. And so that the Celie we saw before, right? Because every time, I feel like when you adapt, you want to take the story, if you can, to a deeper level, right? So the Celie that we had saw before was always a character I felt like I was madly in love with her and wanted her to win, but I didn't know those innermost secrets with her. We didn't have that. Yeah. And because we have those other stories, we now can go to a different place. And so when she sings, you know, oh, that's what she's been thinking all that time, right? And this is what she wants. And of course, in
the theater,
yes,
you don't, the one thing that you don't really get, I mean, unless you're working at somewhere like Classic Stage, you don't really get the power of the close-up, you know?
Oh.
I mean, and that's what you said there about the song being the thing that only the audience and that performer know at that moment in time. I mean, I'm Here, that great song she sings near the end of the musical, it is like a Shakespeare soliloquy. That's what Shakespeare does with his soliloquies. They are the moments that only the audience hears, not anybody else.
That's right.
And that's so powerful. It's so powerful.
True. Yeah. What bigger gift is that?
I know.
As an audience person, that's the big gift. Yes.
So lovely to talk to you. Is there anything you want to ask me before we go?
You know, can I ask you, and I know this is probably like a risky question, but do you have a favorite musical?
Well, I have a favorite musical writer, okay? So, and it's because I've done lots of his work, so Stephen Sondheim would be my...
Oh, yes.
Right?
Yeah,
absolutely. Because I think he's not only a great, great musical songwriter, he's also a playwright, really. You know, his songs are plays, they're one-act plays. And so then if I had to choose one of his plays, if I had to take one of his musicals to a desert island, it would probably be Pacific Overtures, because I think it's kind of audacious.
Yes.
And I'm not sure, I love the three pieces of work that he's done with John Wideman, Pacific Overtures, Roadshow, which I did the premiere of with them, and Assassins, which we're doing at Classic Stage. That trio of that show, those three shows are very important to me because they're highly intelligent. And,
yes.
You know, I love when the musical theater can go to a place of real intellect as well, because the danger with the musical is of thinking, oh, well, it's just, you know.
Right. Exactly.
And it can be so much more than that.
Absolutely.
If you said to me, what's your favorite sort of fun musical? It would undoubtedly be Guys and Dolls, because I think it's brilliantly constructed.
Yeah.
And what do I think is the greatest musical of all time is probably West Side Story.
I agree. With you.
I think it's probably the greatest. And that extraordinary group of artists working on it together. And yes, you can look at those stories now and say, okay, you know, I mean, really, I Feel Pretty, should that really be written now?
Right.
take these things, I say this to my students all the time, take it in its time. You know, do I think we should be doing Showboat anymore? Probably not. But take it in 1927 what it was doing then, and then you see what it meant.
Right.
And sort of value the stories for their time and place, I think is vital. And if we're going to have a heritage,
absolutely,
it's vital.
I agree 100%. I was having this conversation with a friend. I said, we have to, even these pieces that are problematic, we have to look at them. And then we have to have another, otherwise you can't, if you just bury it, then all that history is lost, right?
Absolutely.
If you actually present it and then have the conversation that they couldn't have back then, then not only do you get, okay, this is what our history was, this is what we can do to do better, and what can we pull from it and still learn? You know what I mean? So important.
So important. You know, if we hadn't, I'm going to be make an obvious through line here, but if we hadn't had Showboat, we wouldn't have had Carmen Jones.
Right.
If we hadn't had Carmen Jones, we may not have had The Color Purple. And if we hadn't had The Color Purple, who knows what might be coming.
Right, exactly.
You know, and that's, to me, that's a very obvious, very cliched, but exciting trajectory.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely.
I'm excited by the fact, I mean, this has been happening for quite some time now, but I'm excited by the fact that the musical theater is ceasing to be the domain solely of white men. You know, yeah. that I find it's very exciting for the future of Absolutely. The American.
I'm excited about that. My last, I just want to concur with you said earlier. I'm also excited about the radical musical and not the sort of, you know, I don't want to use Disney, but you know what I mean? The very commercial.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? I'm very excited because I love musicals, but I'm more into like Sondheim's work, but and also these new musicals that are coming up that are challenging the form.
That's right.
In interesting ways. I think it's so important.
I think there's two parts to that too. It's about challenging the form, and then I think the methodology with which they are done should challenge the form.
Absolutely.
You know, it should be, we should always be thinking, okay, there doesn't have to be an orchestra in the pit. They can be on stage. It doesn't have to be, you know, there are many ways to do it. And really, I've been very lucky in my profession that I've been given the opportunity to challenge that form at certain times. And I think that's really vital. Otherwise, Otherwise, we're stuck in a rut of how to make things, you know.
Absolutely. Very dangerous.
Take great care, my friend.
You too, my friend. I'm so honored to be able to speak to you.
I do hope you enjoyed that just as much as I did. At Classic Stage, we recently launched our Coming Back Stronger campaign. It's a fundraising campaign designed to expand our artistic programming to reflect all voices, welcome all audiences to a safe space, address the immediate financial impact of the shutdown, and secure our future. The Coming Back Stronger campaign begins with you. Gifts of $50 or above will be recognized on our virtual donor wall on our website. Thank you for watching, and see you next week.